Now, why measure jumps to start with? Obviously, some sports like basketball or volleyball have jumps as a key factor in their performance, but not necessarily all sports, and certainly they're not the only factors in performance. So, what makes jump testing so popular? Well, these tests are generally an easy way to measure muscle power capabilities. And we can use different types of tests to assess different types of physical capacities within the body. Something we're going to talk about when we compare, for instance, the countermovement jump with a drop jump. With the different jumps, we're able to track the outcome of a jump. That might just be the jump height. Or if we have access to a force plate, we'll be able to get insights into the power and the velocity produced by the individual during their jump. Welcome back to Global Performance Insights. My name is Jo Clubb, and I'm applied sports scientist and founder of Global Performance Insights. This video is a continuation of our athlete testing series in collaboration with VALD Performance. So let's get straight into talking about all these different jump tests. Where best to start than with the counter movement jump? This is probably the most commonly implemented jump in applied practice. I like to think about this like an elastic band. You pull the elastic band back and then you let it go and it goes back further. And that's what we do in a counter movement jump. We squat down and use that elastic energy in our muscles to then propel ourselves upwards. This jump is probably the most popular because, quite frankly, it's relatively simple and feels quite familiar to athletes. This triple extension movement extending through the knees and the hips is something that most of us learn how to do even as children, and so it's pretty easy to coach an athlete through it. But there are some important cues. You need to decide if you want to permit the athlete to use their arm swing to help propel them, potentially to then reach a higher height. This kind of jump is referred to as a Balakov jump, named after the scientist who created this type of test in which an arm swing is allowed. Personally, I tend to have the hands on the hips and avoid allowing the arm swing because generally I'm using the counter movement jump as an assessment of lower body capacity. And if you incorporate arm swing, then you're not only just allowing the upper body strength and coordination to be a factor, but you don't know to which part is the upper body and which part is the lower body. So it depends on your goals for the test, but generally, if you're looking into lower limb capacities, you might want to instruct the athlete to keep their hands on their hips and remove the arm swing. So here is an example of a force time curve that you'd expect to see with a counter movement jump. At time point one, we have the athlete immediately before the start of the jump with this quiet, stable line, which I'm going to talk about more in a moment. As the athlete initially descends, they start to fall with gravity, and this is known as the unweighting phase, in which force actually decreases below body mass. But then, as the athlete starts to apply the force to decelerate themselves as they start to near the ground, the force increases back above body mass. Point two is the deepest part of that initial squat down in the counter movement jump, in which we change from an eccentric phase into the concentric phase. The concentric phase then is associated with the upward phase of the jump before, as you can see in time point three, we are in flight. Force is at zero as the individual is off the force plates before then landing back on the force plates, with time point four here showing the peak landing force generated during the landing phase before the athlete then becomes stationary again. Something really key to look out for across all the jumps we're talking about is to check the body weight beforehand. We're going to expect the athlete to be in a quiet phase before the jump so that a system such as VALD Performance's ForceDecks can capture an accurate body weight. But it's also critical then that they are still immediately before the jump so the system knows when the jump has started. If you have a wobbly line here, and you don't have that clear-cut, free jump quiet phase, then you may want to conduct another trial and remove that one from your data. If you are wanting to learn more about force plates, then have a look at my other video in this series all about the science within a force plate to better understand how they work. As I talk about in that force plate video, VALD's ForceDecks is an example of a dual force plate system whereby we have separate left and right force plates so we can assess even within a bilateral movement that uses both the left and right limbs at the same time, the relative contribution of both sides to that output. You might also want to conduct single leg unilateral tests to assess the single limb capacity of the left and the right sides. We might do this using a single leg counter movement jump. Couple of things to look out for here are a decision around how the athlete should hold their other leg. If you allow the athlete to have it behind them, for instance, there's a tendency for them to want to swing that limb up and utilize it to help with their momentum. We want to cue them to keep the limb that's being assessed in isolation as much as possible. So I tend to instruct athletes to have their other limb straight out in front of them and to avoid trying to use it. And again, we need to be clear about our cue with our arms and our hands. So for me, hands are on hips and we want to avoid allowing them to use an arm swing. Another commonly employed jump test is a squat jump. So in this instance, the athlete squats down and holds that squat in their starting position. You want them to squat down into a fairly deep squat and most importantly to hold it there and again be still. Then we're going to instruct them to jump straight up. This then makes the jump a concentric only jump. It removes the eccentric portion that we see in a counter movement jump, and it removes their use of their stretch shortening cycle. This is really useful because we are honing in on their concentric only capacities in the lower limb. As always, you want to check the jump visually. Often you can see athletes dip down during the squat jump, in which case the trial should be removed. You can also assess this by looking at the force time curve and making sure there's no dip in that curve. The trace should go straight up from that flat line of their body weight.
ForceDecks, the world's fastest, easiest, and most powerful dual force plate system. Assess physical performance in seconds. Jump, land, squat, push, pull, and more. ForceDecks automatically analyzes more than 20 common tests. You can even record video, which is automatically synced with your force data. Then find all your data and reports in one place, VALD Hub, including integrated norms based on millions of data points, helping give context to your athlete's results. And it's not just ForceDecks. You'll find all your VALD data in VALD Hub. One login, all of your performance data. Welcome to VALD.
If you have both a counter movement jump and a squat jump with your individual athlete or client, then you can combine the performance from these two tests and assess what is called the eccentric utilization ratio. This is also known as the EUR, whereby we look at perhaps the jump height or peak power is also used, ultimately your outcome measure from both the counter movement jump as a ratio to the same metric for the squat jump. And this is highlighting how well an athlete is able to utilize their stretch shortening cycle. In theory, with the use of the stretch shortening cycle, you should be able to jump higher than you can in just a concentric only jump, such as the squat jump. So we're looking really for a ratio above 1.1. This would identify that the athlete is performed at least 10% better in the counter movement jump when they were able to utilize their stretch shortening cycle than they did with their squat jump. So this is very much like the dynamic strength index, whereby we look at the counter movement jump performance compared to the isometric mid-thigh pull. If you're not familiar with that, then I also have a video in this series explaining about that. But for now, what do you do with this ratio, the eccentric utilization ratio? If you're above 1.1, it suggests that you're performing well with your stretch shortening cycle. So perhaps you want to focus more on strength training to try and build your capacity. if your EUR is less than one, so you're performing better in your squat jump than your counter movement jump, then you probably want to include a bit of a plyometric focus in your athlete's training, because you have a stronger base foundation in your body that's shown through the squat jump, but you're not transferring this with the use of the stretch shortening cycle. So really, you want to work on those plyometric explosive capacities. Now, talking of plyometric abilities, that brings me on nicely to the next jump, and that is the drop jump. In this jump, we have an individual starting from some kind of height, normally stood on a box, and then the key is to try and spend as much time on the floor as possible, but as much time in the air as possible. This then is an assessment of their plyometric ability, their efficiency in absorbing but also transferring force. We don't just want them to land, we want them to land and go again in the rebound jump.
Here you have an example of the force trace you'd expect to see with a drop jump. You can see that with the athlete starting off the plate on top of the box, the force trace starts at 0 newtons. There's a sharp increase in force as the athlete lands on the plate, with VALD using a 20 newton threshold to determine when landing has occurred. The trace reaches a peak impact force from the drop jump. There is then a reduction in force as the athlete tries to absorb and overcome this force before they then start the concentric phase of the upward jump in that rebound portion of the drop jump. In this portion of the jump, then you witness the peak drive of force the athlete can attain before takeoff for the rebound jump is then achieved. We then see the second landing point and the peak landing force associated with that second landing.
Because there is a notably shorter contraction time and contact time in this jump, this is therefore a better assessment of an individual's reactive strength ability. They are reacting to the drop and trying to transfer that strength. We can try and quantify that capacity by using the reactive strength index. This is normally calculated either by looking at the ratio of jump height to contact time, or sometimes the flight time to contact time. Now, as always with a ratio, it's important we look at the component parts as well, because maybe they're just rubbish in both and therefore it's equalizing it themselves out. But our reactive strength index gives us this insight into an individual's ability to quickly change between this eccentric demand to the concentric demand. So you might use a set height for this over time. You may also look at how their reactive strength ability changes according to different jump heights. But of course, this is firstly a more technical jump, and as well can be more physically demanding, particularly at the higher jumps. So you have to be quite critical about who you implement this with and how. What jump heights you select for them, whether they have the capability of safely conducting this test, particularly those who are in rehab returning from injury. So there we have brief introduction to your counter movement jump, both bilateral, single leg, your squat jump and how we can combine those two together, as well as our drop jump. So thank you to VALD Performance for sponsoring this video, but also this whole series talking about athlete testing. And if you want to check out some more of the videos in those series, I'll put the link below. Thanks for watching. I'll see you again soon for another Sports Science Insights video.